Taking place at the Piercy residence, I'm interviewing James Piercy. Birthday, 06-42... Wait, scratch that. 06-22-49. 614 West Spencer Avenue. Marion, Indiana. What war or wars did you serve in, and what branch of service did you serve in?
I served in the Army.
What was your rank and what was your rank?
E5.
And where did you serve?
I served in the United States, in Germany, and Vietnam. A couple of different duty stations in Vietnam. Spookman and Longman. Spookman is PHUOC. VINH.
V starts in New York.
Right. And Longbin, L-O-N-G, V-I-N-H.
One letter, two?
Two.
All right. And where were you living before the war?
I lived with my parents in Martinsville, Indiana.
Why is it that you enlisted?
My father was in the Army in World War II. Army paratrooper, and I wanted to do what he had done in the Army.
So, do you recall the first days of the Army?
Pretty miserable.
How so?
Got your hair shaved, you were treated like you were the lowest living specimen on the face of the earth.
Tell me about some of your training experiences.
We trained in everything from drill and ceremony through weapons, the uniform of military code, uniform code of military justice, weapons training, hand-to-hand combat, bayonet training, escape and evasion.
Okay, so where exactly in Vietnam did you serve?
Boot bin, long bin, and various other temporary duty assignments. A couple of come to mind with Tamien City, T-A-Y, N-I-N-H, two words.
Tamien.
Right. And Song Bay, S-O-N-G.
What was it like when you first arrived?
It was pretty scary. We didn't know what to expect. It looked like a normal airport when you arrived, other than the culture and the people were considerably different. The dress was totally out of character for anything I'd ever seen.
So tell me some of your experiences as a paratrooper.
Basic paratrooper training in Fort Benning, Georgia, consisted of 3 weeks to intense training. We also made 5 Hollywood static line parachute jumps and 1 full combat parachute jump with 65. 90 pounds of additional equipment besides the parachute and the lift.
Fort Benning's?
Fort Benning, Georgia.
B-E-N-E-N-E-N. So what was your assignment as a paratrooper?
Actually, I was not given an assignment as an actual paratrooper. I was a rated paratrooper. They put me in an MOS as a combat engineer, and that's military occupational specialty. I was a combat engineer, rated as a paratrooper. So most of my Army life was basically combat engineer work. No parachute assignments.
Did you see a lot of combat?
Saw considerable combat as far as I was concerned. Hitting more than enough. Our base at Phu Binh was, we had rocket and mortar attacks usually every night. Viet Cong or the NVA would throw 6 to 8 rockets in and maybe 5 to 10 mortar rounds, and then they'd be gone. The wire was approached on 2 or 3 different occasions that I remember. They weren't able to breach the perimeter and get into the base, but we were at a pretty high intensity level of combat all around us, and we went out to various projects, fire support bases, bridge sites, anything where a combat engineer was working, and you had to be on guard all the time. And we had infantry with us, cavalry units all the time, but you still had to basically watch yourself also. These guys were looking out for their own, so we had to look out for our own also.
Did your unit sustain many casualties?
No. The only casualties that I recall. The only casualties that I can recall were fire support base tanks. Charlie Company were overrun probably about a month and a half before I came home in 1971. They lost. I don't recall for sure, Christopher, but I think it had 21 dead and 33 injured, including, and it was not called fire support base base at that point, but I can't remember, but the Charlie Company commander at that time was Lieutenant Pace, and they named fire support base after him posthumously. And then about 6 or 7 weeks before I went to Long Bend, I spent the last few remaining days of my tenure in Vietnam at Long Bend. Some guys from the supply unit, headquarters company, there was a convoy going to Ben Juan to pick up supplies, and the convoy was ambushed. Lost 3 people, as I recall. They were able to stave off the offensive by Viet Cong. Ben Hoa is BEN space HOA.
What are some of your more memorable moments in Vietnam?
I think just the camaraderie and closeness that you dealt with to suppress some of the fear. And it wasn't all bad, and actually Vietnam was a very beautiful country at that time. Overlook the shell craters and stuff. It's just a beautiful tropical country with a lot of triple and double and single canopy jungles. And we, in our free time. time that we did have, tried to enjoy that as much as we could. Generally, the fire support base in your area was actually cut out of that jungle with clear fields of fire all the way around the perimeter. And so it wasn't like you were actually up right next to the jungle, but you were close enough that you know, you had the occasional bird fly over that was something you'd never seen before, an animal you'd never seen before. Plus your forays on patrol, went out to one of the engineer sites. Kind of remember taking a bridge site at Budop, BU space DOP. Seemed like we put a bridge in there on Monday, and the next Monday we put the bridge back in again in some form or fashion. But we had a lot of South Vietnamese civilian help that was helping the two engineer companies that were at that bridge site. And I was able to see my first in the wild python there. And that was kind of a pretty interesting cave. Plus it just abounded in wildlife. It was pretty much jungle clear down to the riverbank. Free time you generally devote to writing home and trying to keep in contact with parents. That, and I don't know if you consider that, if you have memorable occasional
moments.
I'm sure there were more than that. I can't dredge them up right at this point. I know that the NCO club was generally a night to night hangout. Once you were off duty, that's pretty much it. Once you got a shower, all we had available to us was cold water. If you were fortunate enough, you got to set your water tank up pretty high out in the direct sun, so that by 5 o'clock when you were off duty, you had at least warm water to take a shower with. And then it was either to the mess hall or the NCO club. Played a lot of cards, a lot of peanuts, a lot of youth. That's about it.
How did you receive some of the awards that you got?
Good Conduct Medal. You were awarded a Good Conduct Medal if you've been in a year. Had a good record, kept your medal clean. The ARCOM, Army Commendation Medal, you have to be selected by a superior officer or an higher ranking NCO to award that medal. And I was selected by the operations officer and then also the operations sergeant because of the exemplary job that I did for the operations section.
How are some of the ways that you stay in touch with your family?
Generally, letter writing. I also have a thing called Mars. I don't remember what the exact name of Mars is, but it's where some amateur ham radio operators hook you up and get you passed through on a landline somewhere so you can talk to the party or talk to them. I made three Mars calls while I was in Vietnam and two of my parents and one of my grandparents. And then on R&R, you had access to cell phones to be able to call and talk to them.
What were the living conditions like?
They were bad in the rear. Even some of the base camps were, although they were pretty primitive, they still had fairly decent living conditions even in the rainy season. They were up, elevated up off the ground, so you were at least out of the mud. Our rear area were 10 Quonset hut type billets, large buffer between each hooch, and if you couldn't get out there in time, the incoming was coming in, you could survive your ordeal underneath your boat, you know. The outside walls were sandbagged already outside the hooch, and there was about a 2 or 3 foot buffer in between it and the building itself. So that part of it wasn't too bad. We didn't have running water, so to speak, because we had potable water. Had shower blanket before. Just from the gravity flow system, and they used the black tainted fuel bladder that held 550 gallons of fuel on it. Take those before they put fuel in, paint black, and use potable water for showering and stuff. So the living conditions were rudimentary, but they were okay.
Do you consider it a stressful time for you?
I don't know how to differentiate between stress and fear. I think you probably deal with them pretty much the same fashion. But yeah, it was a high stress scenario. You never knew. The bad thing was you didn't know who the bad guys really were. The bad guys could be, your local Vietnamese barber that was coming on the coast every day and cutting hair. It could be the Vietnamese lady that comes every day and cleans your hooch and did your laundry and that kind of thing. You just never knew. And so there was some hesitation in the back of your mind, what was. And it was stressful. But again, I don't know if it was more fear than stress or more stress than fear, but you learn to deal with it. You learn to work with each other as a team unit. And after a while, you just became accustomed to that everyday stress and being worn down all the time mentally. Once the day was over, and it took its toll physically too, but we tried hard to stay in shape for a year or two. We didn't have mandatory calisthenics or PT like we had in basic AMT, but a lot of us ran, got a company road that was around our perimeter at Phu Binh. It was 3.2 miles. So a lot of guys ran the perimeter road all the time. I wasn't that into running, so I ran our company road most of the time. It was about 3/4 of a mile long, so I ran from one end to the other. We lifted weights. Just pretty much tried to leave that stress angle real good.
What did you and the others do to entertain yourselves?
We played a lot of cards. I'm beating up a lot of cribbage. We had our own baseball diamond, our own basketball court, and four goals that were set up on a half court system. We also had a volleyball pit. Other entertainment. To get a USO show, I think it was once a month, or once every 2 months. A real American USO tour, and then in the ensuing time period between various people would get a Taiwanese or somebody from Singapore or Thailand to bring some kind of Southeast Asian band in or performing troupe of some kind, so that was about once a week, once every 2 weeks we did a show like that. in a row before noon when we get there and change and move on to something else. But we got enough stuff to keep us on.
What did you do while on leave?
Good question again, please.
What did you do when you were on leave?
I went to Sydney, Australia, and to Hawaii. Both places I enjoyed lunch. Thank you. My favorite of the two was in Sydney. That, I think, is as far away from home as I've ever been. And had I known then what I know now, I probably would have done some things differently while I was there. I can't remember the Armed Forces Travel Agency set up our hotel, had 2-day trips to New Zealand, and I probably would have gone to New Zealand had I known then what I know now. They had a 1-day excursion to Great Barrier Reef, and I probably would have tried to do that too, but more of the social aspects of Sydney. And we were there when they were having winter, and so it wasn't really conducive to going to the beach. Although the Australianites, when we went to the beach one day, and the wind was blowing so strong, had to stay bent into the wind all the time and move the balance. But they still had people out there surfing, and they were surfing in wetsuits. And it was a little bit different, but it was a neat place.
Were there any unusual or humorous events that happened?
One that comes to mind right off, our company had a monkey that was adopted as a kind of a mascot. This monkey was fine for about 5 or 6 months, and started getting bigger and a little more inquisitive. We used to have a hors d'oeuvre that we prepared on pork rind with hot sauce on them. The monkey got in with some leftover pork rinds and opened a bottle of hot sauce. And I think it actually damaged his brain function to some effect. And, he became real mean and had never been mean to that point. You used to find him lounging in the rafters all the time. It was just as friendly as could be. Loved to have his ears rubbed. Loved to get picked on, buzzed off of him. He was real decent to have around, never messed in the place. And all of a sudden, after the experience with the hot sauce and the pork rinds, it changed his whole attitude. And he finally attacked people if they walked into foods he'd never done before. And it just got to be a real humorous situation. So if they bit somebody who was about 1.5 inches four long canine teeth, had to physically be removed from this guy's shoulder. It happened to be an NCO, a ranking NCO, so that was pretty much the end of the month. At that point, it had been pretty funny for a couple of weeks. You couldn't even rattle a sack that had pork rinds in it because he was so crazy. That's one of the humorous things. We also had an instance where the Air Force guys that ran the airfield at Hoop Bend, we were right in the middle of the monsoon season. All the ditches, overflow ditches and stuff, were kind of bank full with water. They called and wanted to know if we had anybody that could come and unflow the culvert. So three of us, all our engineer companies were out in the field, and that left our headquarters company to deal with the situation. requesting to get some bow rakes down there and just pulling the debris up and trucking it off. We got there and it didn't seem to be real bad. Finally had to get down in the ditch, three of us, and just kind of start taking it off hand by hand. Somebody upstream from us decided they were going to dump. I never did learn to count, but they dumped at least three or four or five 55-gallon drums of tar in the water just to get rid of the barrel and stuff. And we just happened to be caught where we could quickly escape the path of this tar. Unfortunately, the three of us got pretty well doused in tar. We didn't come real good. We got out of it. It took about a month to get that stuff completely off your skin and out from under your fingernails and out of your hair and stuff. And then I'm sure there was others. Those two come to mind pretty readily.
What did you think about your fellow soldiers?
All in all, everybody that was over there, from the guys that had been drafted to the, to use the term wife or the career soldier, I only had one bad experience with non-commissioned officer the whole time I was in, and that was in basic training, and that pretty much took care of itself over time. That was finally mustered out of the Army because some of these tactics you want to do recruits, that problem solved itself. For instance, food men, four gentlemen decided they had about all they could take for the man sergeant major of the headquarters company and tried to frag him. Talked to Fraggy in the front door and Fraggy in the back door. Unfortunately, there was nobody on the beach when they went off. The military police did be involved. Guys had just come off duty on the perimeter, going back to their part of the base, and saw these guys running and stopping. Just as they stopped, and the other two guys pitched the grenades in, and consequently, they went off, so they arrested all four of them. And that was promoted for. They were mustered out under dishonorable circumstances and wound up with some prison time for bugging work. Other than those two experiences, I think everybody I came in contact with, you couldn't ask for better people. A lot of them were not happy to be where they were at, but they knew there was a job to do and they were going to do it for the best of their ability.
Nashville, Leavenworth.
L-E-A, B-E-A, W-O-R-T-H. That's it. Kansas. Might check that on the map. On the computer.
So what was it like for you when your service finally ended?
Last 30 days are a tough road to go down when you leave Vietnam, but you're considered a short time. Actually, it's been a short time for 6 months. You start chopping your days off. But when it gets down to that last 30 days, you're pretty much, you're afraid to brush your teeth. Because you know you're coming home and you've survived. In my case, I've been there already 14 months. Had some hardships and some difficult situations, but managed to make it through. You brush your teeth and you're thinking, pour around, go off in here at any time, sapper attack, somebody can slip in. So all of these thoughts begin to creep into your mind. So that last 30 days was definitely high stress. You're just trying to take care of business. Day off on a short time of calendar and get out of there. And when I got my walking papers, I was about 4 or 5 okay. I mean, you're pretty lucky. They, once you get there, they don't ask you to do anything. So get up in the morning, go eat, and go to Reveille, and then tap some form in the afternoon. You can be there to tap. And that's pretty much the extent of it. They don't care what you do the rest of the day. I was there 3 days. I've got a friend of mine that I come from basic training in IT with. We came back. We got to Traps Air Force Base. There was a few anti-war protesters there, but not many. They were outside the gate, so you were totally removed from them. Bus ride from there to the Oakland Army Base. Got the medical examination, bus shot, never up to date. Got to keep briefing before you left. Final pay. A lot of protesters outside. Online, there was a few. They didn't seem to be real interested in the busload. That busload of guys coming through there, but it just seemed to be a continual thing. They were there all the time. That wasn't bad. Left. I think we were processed out in about 37 or 38 hours. We took a cab to San Francisco International Airport, but we were spit on. Called baby killer. Called. We were called anything they could think of to call us, which was ugly. We thought we weren't expecting that. We were expecting to come on like a World War II hero's welcome, which. And we were oblivious to this. Pretty much. I mean, we got the news and stuff over in Vietnam, but obviously we were fed what they wanted us to hear. We had no idea that the peace protests were as bad as they were. We were accosted by a couple of people in the San Francisco airport. Finally got settled in a bar that was actually guarded by military police and shore patrol. Spent 2 hours in there before a flight. Flew to Chicago and we were treated the same way we got to Chicago. And we were also treated pretty badly by a couple of shore patrol from the Navy. Neither Navyman showed any insignia or decoration for being in Vietnam. Pretty young, probably 17 or 18 year old. Fresh out of short patrol school, apparently. They were not happy with the fact that we were carrying our tickets in our service hat. Asked us to get rid of them, we told them we wouldn't. They started to get pretty ugly about it, and we had to give them a little speech on proper etiquette of short patrol, and talking to Vietnam veterans. And they actually saw the light. Made a comment about our dress code when we were wearing our tickets in our hands. Got to Indianapolis and it was fine. Parents, grandparents, brothers and sisters were there. It was pretty low key, but it was a shock to come to San Francisco and then to Chicago and see what people treated you. You were only doing a job. Trying to promote a free democracy somewhere else in the world and be treated by your own country. That was pretty impressive.
I spelled Travis.
Travis is T-R-A-V-I-S. T-R-A-V-I-S.
Yeah, that's a Travis.
What did you do when you got home?
Took about a month's vacation. Just kind of lounged around. Bought a car, trying to pick up my social life where I left off when I went to the Army. Had a part-time job on the weekends. And then I started coming up here with my uncle, trying to back and forth. Just trying to make the adjustments back to civilian life, which I thought was going to be pretty well done overnight in a snap, but I just wanted to. Not to be. time. It took a long time to make the adjustment, especially, and I saw later, had occasion to go to Flemington a couple of times and see my brother down there and a lot of the IU students pretty much treat me the same way people in San Francisco and Chicago treated us. So I wasn't interested in that situation. Moved up here in the latter part of November 1971. Go back to Fort Park for a long weekend for work. Took a long time. Took a long time to make the adjustment. Took probably 4 or 5 years. And then there was some issues that finally had to get some professional help through. But that's just part of it. It's something you have to deal with.
Did you make any friends in Vietnam that you still keep in touch with?
Yeah. Jim Vernon, the basic training man. Executive officer for an agricultural company in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. He and I don't talk as much as we used to, but I try to stay in touch with him a couple of times a year. Steve Lance and Ed Farley were surveyors at the engineer company I was in Vietnam. I talk to them usually once a month. Once or 2 months, maybe how busy we all are. That's just those 3 people. We used to keep in contact with a sergeant that was in my unit in Germany. It was from Southern Indiana, Rising Sun, Indiana. And I kind of lost track of him about 3 or 4 years ago. Jim Herman, H-E-R, D-O, and Steve Lance, G-L-A-N-T-Z, and Farley, F-H-A-R-L-E.
So has your experiences in Vietnam influenced your life as a civilian?
Sure they have in some way. I don't know whether they've been good, bad, or different. And at this point, I can't tell you even what they are. If I sat down and dissected it long enough, I'd give you a better answer than that, but that's the one I got right now.
Do you ever attend any reunions?
No. I've never been to the Vietnam Veterans Reunion. I read somewhere a year ago where the 20th Engineer Brigade, 31st Engineer Battalion, part of was having some kind of reunion in Missouri. And I was real tempted to go to that. A couple of guys I was in Germany with lived right around Canada, Missouri there. Thought I might like to go look at them, but I didn't.
Is there anything else you'd like to add?
Not as far as my experience is concerned. I would like to add that the current situation we're in now, these young kids went over to water display, water network they show on their part. I've got nothing but gratitude for them. Guys did a great job. Bless them all, they all get home safe and sound. Just couldn't ask for a better military force than we've got. War's hell.